Welcome to Timothy Baptist Church. Y'all can stand as we begin worship.
Welcome to Timothy Baptist Church. Thank you for being here. You can be seated for just a second. So thankful that you've chosen to join us for worship this morning. If you're joining us online, we're thankful to have you as well. Want to welcome everybody. Hope that you've had a good morning to this point. Is everybody enjoying the weather? Yeah? Thank you so much for your understanding everything as you come in about the temperatures and the mask and all that. We appreciate your attitudes of gratitude toward that and continuing to do what we're asked to do. We love you guys. We appreciate you being here to worship with us, and we look forward to seeing what God is going to do in this place this morning. If you're visiting with us, we hope that you've been made to feel welcome. Timothy, let our visitors know we're glad they're here. Now, if you'll bow with me, we'll pray and open our service. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together in your name. God, we thank you for those that have chosen to be here in this place this morning, those that are joining us online. Pray, God, that you would make yourself evident in each and every life represented. God, we pray asking that you'd fill this room with your Holy Spirit, God, that our hearts and our attention would be on you, God, that you would change lives in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Y'all can stand as we continue in worship.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along. put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Never stop.
give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you. So come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you. So come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you. Come on. Come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We'll never stop. We can't live without you, Jesus. We love you, and we can't get enough. All this is for you, Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises he hears faith. There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear worship he hears faith. Awake my soul and sing, sing his praise aloud, sing his praise aloud. Oh, awake my soul and sing, sing his praise aloud, sing his praise aloud. There is a sound that changes things, the sound of his people on their knees. Oh, wake up, you slumbering, it's time to worship him. Awake my soul. Thank you. it'll take it down just a smidge. He's been super heavy. I've prayed and prayed. If this is not of you, don't let me feel that in this moment. And I feel it stronger than I have yet. And so I do feel like he has given me a message to some of you today. And we just sang the words, when he moves and when we pray, where stood a wall, now stands a way, where every promise is amen. And I feel so deeply that we have people in this room that feel like they are facing a situation that is a wall, that they've done everything they can do, that they have prayed and they've done it all, but they feel like there's no way forward. And I don't know, it could be finances, it could be a marriage, it could be a job, it could be illness, it could be depression, it could be anxiety, it could be the election, whatever is consuming your thoughts more than your Savior. And I think sometimes we have a hard time handing those things over. We just saying, hey, oh, let the King of Glory enter in. And sometimes we don't give him room to enter in. And so I feel like somebody in here has forgotten what a powerful God that they serve. And we also sang, where every promise is amen. Amen is translated to so be it, it is so. We say it at the end of our prayers, saying that in faith we spoke that, and in faith we say it will be. And we just sang that, meaning if his promises are amen, they have to be. They have to be. So I know this is a little unconventional, but I wanted, of course I can't unlock it. I wanted to read y'all some of the scriptures that God laid on my heart about his promises. So here we go. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid and do not be discouraged. I love that one because he doesn't send somebody to do it for him. The Lord himself comes. Have I not commanded you to be strong and courageous? Do not be afraid and do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your path straight. And God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and he rescues those whose spirits are crushed. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours. Those are just a few that I found so quickly. And so I want to remind you that you serve a powerful God. And if you are facing that situation, if that is you, all you have to do is raise up your arms and surrender and hand it over. He didn't go to the cross for us to live defeated. He did not do that. So I ask you, I'm gonna pray, and I would never ask you to do something, I'm sorry. I would never ask y'all to do something that you're uncomfortable with. So if you're not comfortable raising your hands, don't do that. But when I pray, I ask you if you're comfortable to raise your hands, not saying, oh, that's me, but saying, God, I surrender it over. Take the load off of me. I want that light load, that easy yoke. And I'm gonna pray, and we are gonna see God release you from these situations. So I'm gonna pray, God, we come to you this morning, God. We know that we serve a mighty God, a God that has said, cast your cares upon me. What a better caregiver for our lives and our souls than you. We could never find another. God, so I pray to every situation in this room, God, everyone who feels that way, God, I pray that you have them raise their arms and surrender and let them feel that burden lift straight off of them. God, we believe that you will do it, and we know, God. And then we ask that you give us the strength to let the King of Glory enter into those situations, enter into our marriages, enter into our jobs, enter into our finances, and whatever that we are facing, God, let you enter in, God. Lord, we know, we just sang it, we know that when you move, the devil and all of his demons shake in fear because they know what a powerful God we serve. So let us know and believe that you will and you can do what you said you will do. God, let us claim those promises today. Here we go. And when he moves, and when we pray, where stood a wall, now stands a way, where every promise is a man. And when he moves, make no mistake, the depths of hell begin to shake. All hail the Lord, all hail the King. Worthy of being worshiped and served for all eternity, God. Lord, we love you. We're excited for what you have for us this morning, God. We pray that all of the burdens that have been lifted, God, that we will not take them back, God, but that we will leave them right where they belong, right there with you, God. Lord, give us the faith to believe that you are who you say you are. God, we love you, and in your name we pray, amen.
Thank you. pre-K and K. You can be dismissed for children's worship. Lord, we just simply ask you to clear our mind of distractions, fill our soul with faith, exercise your goodness and power, speak to us, open our ears to hear you, and unleash yourself in this place. In your name we pray, amen. 1 Corinthians 9:24 through 27 says, "Don't you realize that in a race everyone runs, but only one wins the prize? So run to win. All athletes are disciplined in their training, and they do it to win a prize that will fade away. But we do it to win an eternal prize. So I run with purpose in every step. I'm not just shadow boxing. I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I might myself be disqualified." We're in a race. You're in a race. We got to get our minds and our hearts focused in the principle that the life you live is a race. It has begun. And you are somewhere in the process of this race. And neither you nor I know when that race will end. So you better not be in your recliner. You better be in the race. Because the moment you let your guard down, the evil one will be there knocking on your door. We're in a race. What race are you running? What race are you running? Are you running a race chasing after what God has for you? Or are you running a race trying to please yourself? Are you running a race that will give you eternal happiness with a crown that's incorruptible? Or are you running a race that is chasing the things of this world that will lead to a crown that is corruptible and that fades? "Know ye not that they who run the race run all, but only one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain it. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we, God's people, an incorruptible crown." Run for the prize. That's what I'm talking about this morning. Run for the prize. Run the race and keep your eyes on the prize. Run the race and keep your eyes focused on the prize. In the story that we looked at a very short part of, the Apostle Paul wrote this epistle to reveal the problems, the pressures, and the struggles of the church in Corinth. Corinth was one of the most important cities in Greece during Paul's day. Not only was it the hub of worldwide commerce, but it was also known for its degraded culture. Sounds a lot like America today. Had a lot of idolatrous religion. Anything goes. Hey, let them do what they want. Don't tell them about Jesus. No matter what your struggle, Jesus is always the answer. The church in Corinth was suffering from factions, which is kind of like cliques. They were also suffering from immorality, from questionable practices, abuse of the Lord's Supper, and abuse of spiritual gifts. Honestly, if you name it, this church in Corinth kind of struggled with it at the moment. So Paul writes not only to correct the problems, but to give a message of hope. And that's my attempt today. To give you a message of hope, a message of encouragement, and a message of come on, get up, get busy, we have work to do. Everyone in this room has someone in your neighborhood that's going to hell. Everyone in this room has someone in your workplace that's going to hell unless you retired and staying home. And everyone has someone that you know that's hurting. Just because you have Jesus doesn't mean you don't hurt. But it does mean that you know where to go with your hurt. So once again, know ye not that they who run in a race run the whole race, but only one receiveth the prize. So run that you may obtain it. Man, I just thought of a little illustration, but I don't remember for sure. I think her name's Mary Decker. Mary Decker, a track runner from way back in the day. She was running in the Olympics. She was way out in front. Y'all remember that? Those people kind of start catching up with her. And what was that lady's name that crated her out? Olga? I believe it was Olga. Olga Corbett or something like that. But she begins to crowd Mary Decker out into the side. And all of a sudden you saw Mary Decker's leg just kind of cave in the knee, and she fell and rolled. It was a big ordeal. If you've ever ran track, you know that the race isn't over until it's over. Believe it or not, I used to run track. Gone now. Now I can't even get down to the box. You know, in this text, the Apostle Paul is comparing himself and us as believers to a racer in the ancient Greece Isthmus Games. I didn't say Christmas, it just sounded like it. The Isthmian Games are actually what inspired the Olympics as we know today. Paul uses this analogy of these games to get his point across to the Corinthians. And I have a question for you. Are you on the right track in your life? Have you taken time to check the track for traps, for dips, for rivets, for rocks, for maybe a hurdle that's not quite where it needs to be? You see, we all get so used to living life that we forget to remember what I preached last week. The devil's constantly setting traps up for us. And some of us just start walking and we don't check out where we're going. Sometimes the problems aren't that we're really off track. The problem is that we're not utilizing everything we have for the race. If you're walking this life chasing the things of the world, you'll never live with God's peace ruling your heart. You'll be shadow boxing, as the scripture says. You'll be doing a lot of moving, but you're not making any impact. The only impact you're going to be making is wearing yourself out. It's just tink, 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 tink. But you're tired, but you're making no impact whatsoever. Just swinging here and there, but not making progress. Know ye not that they who run in a race run all, but only one receiveth the prize. So those that are familiar with sports and track know that the fastest race in track and field is the 100 meters. And those There's some people that can run it really quick. But the one thing about this race is that every single step you take is crucial. One small step out of sync can cause you to lose the race. You see, the race is not long enough to make mistakes. So you got to keep your eyes on the prize, and you got to stay focused in. One mistake can make the difference between gold and silver. And that's why one of the things you're taught before competing in this event is to never, ever look to your right or your left, but to stay focused, straight on the prize. You know what? In life, a lot of times we get caught looking to the right or the left. Happens to me at stoplights. That ever happened to anybody around here? You sit at a stoplight, doing your thing, all of a sudden you're sidetracked. And the next thing you know, what are you here? Or whoever's with you saying, light change, bro. It definitely happens. So when you're running the race of life, keep your eyes focused forward and fixed on Jesus Christ. Don't slow down. Don't look to your left. Don't look to your right. Don't look all around. But keep your eyes on the finish line. The Apostle Paul gives us another lesson on running further over in Philippians when he says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Now here's Paul telling us, forget the ground you've covered in the race. Don't waste your time looking at what's happened back there. Don't waste your time worrying about the circumstances that you're in, worrying about the distractions that might come. Don't get caught up in the moment. Too many of us allow a moment to control our future. Press on. You have a race to run, and you have a prize at the end. And when you take your eyes off Jesus, the only place you're going to go is down. The only thing you will do is sink. And as a pastor, I am sure not trying to be a punk, but sometimes I hear people say things or I see posts on Facebook, and it's hard because this pulpit has been teaching it for 20 years. And y'all are asking questions on what to do in those situations. Come on, bro. Come on, sister. We aren't playing jacks up here. We're not just trying to tell you a night-night story. We're trying to get you to plug into life. Life with Jesus. Man, somebody studied till about 12:20 this morning, actually, and put together God's word to feed you from what God gave them. It is not a sitting down and gather around and playing jacks and saying, "I got you." It's saying, "Here's life. You're going to face it. Grab this truth because someday you're going to need it. And then you're not going to want to have to thumb through and find it. Hide it in your heart that you may not sin against God." We got to realize you're here for a purpose. This empty chair, be like Jesus, represents somebody that's not getting what they ought to be getting. Don't just show up, but have your empty plate ready. Because me, Clay, Jason, nobody else can give it to you. It's got to come from God. And I promise, if you're just showing up, you're going to leave hungry. I've sat in church and left hungry. Got home, joy was full. What was the difference? Joy had her plate out. You ain't gonna see me going through the buffet line like this. It's going to be like this. Especially if there's the right thing there. Are you hungry enough for God's word to hold your plate out? That's what he's saying. Keep your eyes on the prize. Look up to Jesus. Shake off the problems. Shake them off. And after you shake them off, stomp them under your feet, knowing that God has them. Just ask Peter if you don't believe me. The very thing, the waves that were scaring the disciples, Jesus walked on it. The things that are about to surround you and drown you, Jesus has control of them under his feet. You stomp on that stuff. Just speak the name of Jesus. Don't let the confusion of this world stop you. Press on. You have a race to run. You have a prize. Stay focused. Press on. Stay focused. Keep working. Stay focused. Keep trying to be great. And not just great, but the greatest. You can call it pride or whatever you want, but I never wanted to be in last place. Amen. If I was going to play that game, I'd just soon win it. I don't care if it is Jax. And as far as a Christian, I want to be the best one, not for you to say, look how good they are, but for my God to say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. I don't want him to see me walking up and think, whew, I'm glad there's thread in that because he barely made it. I'm reminded of the three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were dumped into the fiery pit because they refused to bow down and worship the golden idol. As they were thrown in, they assured Nebuchadnezzar that their God was able. My friend, you're up against the fiery pit in something. Something in your life has got you up against the fiery pit. You need to look the devil right in the eye and say, my God is able. My God is able. They were running the race. They kept their eyes on the prize. They're getting thrown in the fire. Once they got in that fire, all of a sudden, they realized it wasn't just Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, but there was a fourth person in that fire. You are not alone. Jesus says he'll never leave you or forsake you. Don't get all wrapped up when this don't happen like it's supposed to, when that job didn't come like it was supposed to, when that family member acts crazy like you are. No, I'm just kidding. When your children go, and they do, and they will. When your college don't work out like you want it to. When your car won't start again and it's the same problem they've had to fix 10 times. I don't know about you, but I usually do better during a true catastrophe than I do about 10 little silly things. One big one, let's put our arms back and go. 10 little ones, I'm done with these. Anybody else feel that way? Yeah, me too. It drives me crazy. There was four men in the fire. Now I'm reminded of Job, who was diseased, bankrupt, wounded, close to death, discouraged by his wife, forsaken by his friends. But through all those troubles, he kept his eyes on the prize. Through those struggles, he said, though he slay me, yet I will trust him. Man, you got to get some, come on, you got to get a little backbone, Christian. Though it might not pan out like I wanted it to, I'm going to trust him because his plan is better than my plan. Amen. I'm reminded of King David, who was at his best, not sitting on his throne wearing robes of purple and gold, But rather, in the 23rd Psalm, he was passing through the valley of the shadow of death. When he cried out something. Now, he wasn't sitting in the best place in the world when he cried this out. It was a rough spot. And he said, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I'm reminded of my Savior, Jesus Christ, my Redeemer, God's only begotten Son, the second person of the Trinity, Mary's baby, Jesus, who prayed while he bled and died for you and for me. During his time of pain and suffering, he prayed not for himself, but for those responsible for his crucifixion by saying, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. He kept his eyes on the prize. He focused on Jesus. He was running the race, even like this. And he kept on running it. My friend, it gets hard. Come on. It gets hard, but you can't quit running the race. Come on. Buckle down. Buckle up. Do your stretches and get ready. You have a race to run. And just because you're lower than you used to be, and just because it don't look as pretty as it used to look, doesn't mean that the race has changed. Get in the race and run. You've got a job to do. Church, I tell you, I came to tell you today, it's time to run the race. It's time to keep your eyes on the prize. And for some of us, it might be time to get them back on the prize. Don't get caught up in the moment. Don't look back on your past. Look to Jesus. Don't run back to your old life. Run to Jesus. Don't look to this world to solve your problems. Look to Jesus. I tell you, church, we got to start looking to Jesus some more. We need Jesus to run and rule our homes. We need Jesus to run and rule our street corners. We need Jesus to run and rule our jobs. We need Jesus to run and rule our schoolhouses. We need Jesus to run and rule the hearts of people sitting in churches all over America today. We need Jesus to rule our life. And just because you're sitting here in a pew today doesn't mean that he is running your life. We need to look to Jesus in our servitude. We need to look to Jesus in our solitude. And we need to look to Jesus in our gratitude. Run the race. Keep your eyes on the prize. Turn to Jesus. He's the bridge over troubled waters. Turn to Jesus, the way maker, because he can make a way out of no way. Amen. Run your race. Keep your eyes on the prize and look to the one that seeks and saves the lost. Run your race. Keep your eyes on the prize. Focus on Jesus, the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Jesus, the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, my all in all, Jesus. Why, Pastor? Why? Why are you telling us to keep looking to Jesus? Well, I'm telling you to keep looking to Jesus because Jesus is the answer for you and for me. Right now, our world is weird. And most people don't realize it. But there is a spiritual battle going on in every single person's heart and mind in our world. There's a battle going on for lost and saved, but there's also a battle going on for allegiance. Just because you said yes to Jesus doesn't mean you're making a big difference for him today. There's a battle going on for that. And every time you sit in this room or open your Bible at home or listen to a podcast or listen to Christian music, it is an opportunity for God to feed you some truth. I said it before, but have you ever tried to feed a baby something they didn't want to eat? What do? Yeah, just because it goes in doesn't mean they're getting the nutrition they need, right? I mean, for real though, who wants peas? I don't get that. We give them those things and they spit them straight out. And I always want to say, you eat it. See what you do with it. Now everybody that likes peas is offended, but that's all right. You better put something over them for me to eat them, like gravy. I mean, something. Ugh. My mind got on that way more than it should have. Sometimes that's how we are as Christians. We sit and we hear it and we understand that we are being offered a meal spiritually. We've become picky. Instead of listening, we do other things. Just because you pulled up to the table don't mean you're ready to eat. Joy cooks most every Sunday for our family, and can't tell you how many times I hear, eat your food. Eat your food. And I say, I'm trying. Eat your food. I'll look on one side or the other at one of the kids by me. They got a whole plate of food there. Ain't even had a bite. But I ask you, do you ever leave church that way? Do you ever leave church with a full plate of food because you didn't take one bite of what was served up? Do you know you're not in this room to keep up with your phone? Oh, and by the way, for those that do, or your watch. You're in this room because the Holy Spirit of God said, Tamara, Josh, Trash, Ty, Jason, all of us, I got something for you today. I want to change your life today. I want to give you something that maybe not tomorrow and maybe not the next day and maybe not the next, but sometime soon you're going to need it. So stay here. And don't just stay here with your hiney. Stay here with your eyes. Stay here with your heart. Stay here with your whole being. You're running the whole race, not just part of it. The whole race means you're alert and ready the whole time. You know how many games have been lost in the last couple of minutes when people had a big old lead? Because they didn't play the whole game? Well, I don't want to be that guy in my walk, do you? So, Pastor, why? Why is it so important to keep our eyes on the prize and run the whole race? Well, let me tell you, for me, I'm going to press on to the mark of the high calling because eternity depends on it. In fact, I'm going to run for my life because I'm running for eternal life. I want to see Jesus. I want to see Jesus. I have preached over 1,000 funerals. And when I stand up there and say something like this to those that I am very certain of their salvation, the moment they breathe their last breath, their next breath was in the presence of Jesus. When I say that, sometimes it's hard for me to stand there like you're supposed to at a funeral. Because I want to just jump. I want to just say, hallelujah! Because I know one day when I breathe my last breath on this earth, my next one, I get to see the one I've been talking about for years. I get to see the one that I've been dreaming about for years. I get to see the one that I've been telling you. He's the answer. One day, these eyes aren't going to need glasses to see Jesus. In eternity, the only thing that will be present are the things of Christ. And I'm running this race, this old dusty race sometimes, because when this race is over, I'm going to receive that incorruptible crown. I'm running a race to receive my eternal prize. I'm going to spend eternity with Jesus and receive things that will never fade. When I step over into glory, I'm going to wear a crown. I'm going to wear a crown. When that trumpet sounds, oh, I'm going to wear a crown. Soon as my feet strike Zion, I'm going to lay down my heavy burden. I'm going to put on my robe in glory. I'm going to shout and tell my old story. Soon as I can see my Jesus, I'm going to tell him all about my trouble. I'm going to put on my robe in glory. I'm going to shout and tell the whole story. They're going to sing it for us. Ready? Get it. Some of y'all are going to be walking a little bit in rhythm when you get in heaven. You ain't going to know what to think. Lay your eyes on Jesus and just do a woo. You see, you didn't see what I saw. You didn't see what I saw. Because I saw Sheila. And I saw her say, hey, to everybody she's standing around in heaven this morning. Y'all hear that? That's my choir. And she said, as only Sheila can. Sheila was the sister of the syncopated clap. Everybody else up here like this? Sheila's like, she didn't care. Let me tell you, she had heaven going during that song. I saw it. I saw the time she sat in committee meetings in this church and went against every other person because God told her to. During that song. I saw the times she stood with this man and his family when a lot of people didn't. So I saw that during that song. I saw Brenda Boyer during that song, who sang on a choir on a Sunday night and had a wreck and died the next day. Lived a few days, but not many. I saw her in the heavenly choir during that song. We have work to do. Heaven's for more people than the ones in this room today. There are still people who I didn't see. There are still people who, last night, just before midnight, I felt like God kind of pulled the curtain of heaven back and gave me a glimpse in my prayer time. And I'd love to tell you who all I saw, but to be honest with you, they were blurry. I don't know who they were. But I saw Jesus. And I was reminded why we do what we do. And I just came to tell you, Jace, keep pressing toward the mark. JD, keep running the race. Rob, don't turn to your right. Sue, don't turn to your left. Barbara, don't let anybody slow you down. Rita, press on. Sherry, press on. Mike, press on. Houston's, press on. There's no life better than living for God. Sometimes on normal days we forget it. But on those days when you're flat on your back, when you don't feel good, when sin's crept in, when things that you thought would last forever are falling apart, there's really only one name that'll help, and his name is Jesus. It's Jesus. So today I ask you, do you know my Jesus? Have you called on his name for salvation? Are you willing to get in the race? Are you willing to let go of everything that you basically have called life to this point and grab hold of Jesus? Without first saying, okay, tell me everything I have to know. But just saying, I need Jesus. And I'm going to lay it all down. And I'm going to trust him. I'm going to trust him. It's my belief, and I always tell you when it's my belief and not necessarily the scriptures. It's my belief that this church, like most every other, is filled with people who one time got a goosebump when they said the name of Jesus, but it was not salvation. It was a goosebump. Prove it. Yes, sir. Many who say to me, Lord, Lord, will not inherit the kingdom of God. That's my proof. So my question for you is, do you have Jesus? I didn't ask you, bro, if you know Jesus. I ask you if you have Jesus. Right here. If he picks your feet up and puts them down. Even when those mornings when you wake up and say, I do not want to do this today. If he picks your feet up and puts them down and picks them up and puts them down and picks them up and puts them down. And before you know it, it's 9 o'clock at night and you made it. Do you have Jesus? Have you surrendered your all to Jesus? And if you have, whoo, good. Because you're going to get a robe and crown. I'm going to wear. Can you see you? I can see me breaking through the gates of heaven. I don't even care about a crown. I'm going to see Jesus. There's Jesus. But I'll have already seen him because I believe to be absent from this body is to be present with him. And he's going to have my hand as soon as that last heartbeat happens. I thought of that yesterday morning. I get over at a football game and we were all on the wrong side of the field, so we were walking to the other side of the field to watch, and I see little Griffey had a hold of one of Ty's fingers. He's walking along like this, and little Griffey, our grandbaby, has his finger, and they're walking, and I don't know if they're walking Ty's speed or hers, but it seemed like it took them forever to get over there. And every time I'd look, she wasn't letting go of that hand. Last night preparing this, I began to remember that and think about that God will never let go of our hand. Do you know where you're going to spend eternity? I didn't ask you, do you think you know where you'll spend eternity? I said, do you know where you'll spend eternity? I'm going to ask you if you'll be able to bow your head and close your eyes. And I'm going to ask you in your heart to simply answer this question. Say your name right here in the blank. Just say your name in your mind. Think it. For me, I'm going to say, Kelly, do you know for sure if you died right now that you'd go to heaven? Do you know for sure that you would spend eternity with Jesus if you died right now? And I'm asking you to say your name there. And now answer the question. And if you do, start praying, if there's anyone in this room that doesn't, that God will free them today. If you can't say yes to that, I'm going to quickly tell you that you must A, admit that you're a sinner, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And in admitting that sin, you must repent. Turn away and ask God to help you to follow him. B, you must believe in the name of Jesus for salvation. John 14:6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There's no way to the Father except through me. Jesus is speaking there, and he is not a way, he is the way. And we must believe that. And then we must take that admission of sin and that belief in him and drop it about 18 inches from our head to our heart. And commit our life to him. We must choose Jesus. He has already chosen you, or you wouldn't feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit right now to call on him for salvation. And if you're in this room and you cannot say, yes, I know without a shadow of a doubt, Pastor, that if I die, I'm going to heaven, then I'm going to just pray a simple prayer, and I'm going to ask you to silently repeat it in your heart, or whatever God would lay on your heart to pray, you pray that. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. And I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Help me turn away from my sins. I believe you are the Son of God, and I believe you are the only way to heaven. And though I don't understand it all, I know that I need you and I want you. And I come now just committing my life to you and asking you to give me the gift of eternal life and the gift of your presence in my life right now. I surrender myself to you. With every head bowed and every eye closed. If you're here this morning and you prayed that prayer, I simply want to ask you just to look up at me until our eyes meet. I'm going to ask you to do two things, and that's the first thing. If you prayed that prayer, just look up at me until our eyes meet. Thank you. Others, just look up at me. Thank you. Thank you, sister. Thank you. I see you. Every head bowed and every eye closed. In just a moment, I'm going to pray and we're going to have an altar call. And when we do that, whether you raised your hand or not, whether you looked up at me or not, if there be any man, boy, woman, girl, that's willing to let the shackles fall off and step into the freedom that God has for you. After I pray, I'm going to ask you to just step out and come up here and tell one of these guys I prayed that prayer. Revelation 3:20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and sup with him and he with me." Maybe you're here today and you know you're saved, but you know you've taken your eyes off the prize. You've gotten distracted. Life became heavy. Life became hard. And you know you're Jesus' child, but you also know that you need to refocus and you need to get your eyes on the prize and keep them there. And if that's you, after we pray, this altar is wide open for you. Come and spend some time with Jesus and commit whatever it is that he has for you to him. Father, we love you. And we thank you for loving us. And we thank you for your wonderful presence in our lives. And Lord, I ask you to unleash the chains on anyone in this room that needs to come to you, God, whether they prayed that prayer or whether they didn't. Let them come forth and speak to one of these gentlemen. And if the church, those who know you, have gotten sidetracked, Lord, bring them back into the race full-fledged so they can run the whole race. Let us keep our eyes on the prize, Lord. Bring them to the altar to commit themselves wholly and completely to the race that you've called them for. Not to run it for a few days or a few weeks or a few months, but to run it for a lifetime. Move in us today, God. In your name we pray. Amen. Stand, please. Allie's going to lead us. This altar is open. If you prayed that prayer, come. Tell one of these guys so they can help you. Others, come. Find a spot at this altar. Renew your commitment to the race.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working. working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you.
Working, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
So it feels just a tad like deja vu. A few years ago, we gathered over Addie and her family as she was going into something very unknown for them, into Cincinnati to have this surgery that's crazy and unheard of, but God. Now, a few years later, Big Sis gets to go through. She gets to, the torch is passed, and she's going to be leaving soon to go have the same surgery. And this family is unfortunately and fortunately facing something they know a little about now, which is a blessing and a curse. So I just want us to pray for them. I want us to pray over them. And I want you to get their pictures in your mind and in your heart so you can pray for them every day. And just keep lifting them up over and over and over, so that they know and they feel the presence of God and the love of His people. I'm going to ask Clay if he will just to pray over you guys. Other kids, y'all come up too. Jameson kids. The whole church.
Thank you.
It's a little bit difficult because these get to stay back here and kind of keep doing life. Okay.
Continue to pray for the Jamesons. They leave later at the end of this week. They'll be gone for a while. So definitely be praying for all of them, specifically Gracie. So, hey, thanks for being here. We have, today's a busy day. So right after this morning service, if you are a new member, new attender, we're having a meet the staff luncheon at the lodge. It's 5000 West Fern Mountain Road. If you've been coming in 2020, and you're new or you've recently joined the church, if you consider yourself new, come eat lunch with us. We're going to just tell you kind of about our church, about us as individuals, as far as the staff goes, ministries that we do. Some you've seen, may have seen, some you haven't, due to the world that we live in right now and the state of everything. But love for you to come. You didn't have to RSVP. If you're here and you're like, well, I'd like to hear what they have to say. I'd like to get to know some of the staff. I'd like to eat lunch for free. You know, come on down, 5000 West Fern Mountain Road at the lodge, and enjoy an afternoon. Then tonight at 5:30, we have our pastor appreciation banquet at the lodge. That's 5000 West Fern Mountain Road. I feel like I've said that already about five times. But come, dinner again. You want to eat? Hey, man, we got you covered. Come, we're going to have a doozy of an evening, I'm sure. And I'll close with this. Oh, okay. That's a better laugh than I usually get. So anyway, I'll close with this, okay? Why do skeletons stay so calm? Because nothing gets under their skin. Here's Dumplin'.
As Clay mentioned, tonight at the lodge at 5:30 is Pastor's Appreciation. At the doors as you leave out, we're going to have plates for the last time. If you would like to show your pastor some appreciation, just drop it in there and we'll take care of it. But please be there tonight. If you bow your heads, I'll pray and we'll close. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for your love, Lord. Lord, thank you for being a God, Lord, that wants to be involved in our lives, Lord. And Lord, I don't understand why you want to use me to reach other people, Lord, but that's what you've asked me to do, Lord. And Lord, help me to go in your strength, Lord. Help me to go in your power, because I know I can't do it on my own, Lord. And Lord, help us to reach those that are lost, Lord. And let's help us to comfort those that are hurting, Lord. And Lord, help us to just continue to pray, Lord, for our world, Lord. We love you. We thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.